Since 1996, Marie-Ange Boyer has been director of the FRAC, of the Centre Régional of Contemporary Art Collection in Orléans, where the collection is, in fact, channeled towards the linkage between art and research architecture. So it's a centre of art, but linked with the architecture, and in fact, absolutely linked in this case. The FRAC Center has been putting together a collection to do with architecture in its utopian and experimental dimension from the 50s, yeah, practically today. In fact, today, because it continues and it's a work in progress. In 1999, she founded with Frédéric Migueroux, this is a very absolutely, I need to read because sometimes Frédéric Migueroux was the other director of the Archilab events at the beginning, in the first editions, and Frédéric was another very important accomplice in this kind of debates and sharing energies. And she founded with Frédéric Migueroux the Orléans International Architectural Conference, Archilab, which brings together young international practitioners and architects involved in the last forms of architecture. And this was absolutely important. In 2002, Marie-Ange Boyer was appointed with Béatrice Simoneau, who was the other co-director of Archilab, as curator of the French Pavilion at the Venice Biennale of Architectures in the 8th International Exhibition of Architecture. And in 2008, she was associate curator of the 3rd International Biennale of Contemporary Art of Seville, BIAC, for the Jauniverse Exhibition, Young Universe Exhibition, with Peter Weibel as general curator. It was a very, very important event also, and very important manifestation of advanced architecture. In 2013, she will curate Archilab, she will curate because it's the new event, naturalizing the architecture. This is more or less your exhibition, your lecture, and in fact Archilab is a premiere practically. It's the first, well, no, Marianne showed me, it's the first time that I will explain the new edition, the new issue of Archilab for us. And with Frédéric Migueroux again, art and architecture critic, Marie-Ange Boyer has published numerous articles in her domain, in magazines, catalogs. So she's very new in this, in the diffusion culture, and she's currently working on a doctorate tracing the architectural model since the Renaissance by tracing the history of its representation at the, the School for Advanced Accessories in the Social Sciences. And this is, for us, is very important also in the, this our new PhD program of research that we are trying to do here, connecting the fabrication and the production with the thinking and the fundamental research. And thank you very much, Marie-Ange. Thank you also for this premiere or this, first explanation, and I hope the best for you and for the Archilab, and I will be there, and you will be in the new edition of Archilab in September. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much, Manuel. I can add that you were also very important for all these editions of Archilab, because Manuel Gauza, Actar, Metapolis were among the first guests of Archilab. And good evening. Thank you very much to be here. So today I will present you the next issue of Archilab. I think that Manuel told you everything about Archilab and the FRAC Center collection. And it is true that the FRAC Center collection and Archilab are very linked together. And in fact, Archilab has been created was created in 1999 by Frédéric Migueroux and myself, and the idea was to create an international laboratory for architecture and to defend a young generation of architects dealing with digital processes and so on, And at that time, when it was created, Archilab was very criticized because many people told us that it was just a joke, and that's it. And now, after 20 years of digital revolution, we can see all the steps from this period up to now. And so Archilab is a leading international event and for architecture engaged in research and experimentation. I will present you a few slides about the new issue of Archilab. And this next edition will be curated by Frédéric Miguerou and myself. And it will be dedicated to the interaction between digital architecture and life sciences, biotechnology, neurosciences, genetics, and so on. So as you know, today the utilization of software programs for designing architecture make possible for architects to simulate a new kind of organic architecture. And the same processes now are among scientific disciplines, art, architecture, and design. So in this new edition of Archilab, we have invited 40 architects, but also designers and artists. So this lecture will present you for the first time this dialogue between architecture and the sciences within the computational field. As you know, yes, today, after the digital revolution, architects are using life sciences, neurosciences, synthetic biology, thermodynamics, physics, chemistry, artificial intelligence, and many architects today are working in a systemic approach to the living, its possibility of replication, its capacity of self-organization and emergence. And many of the architects that we will show in this edition are working within a kind of computational ecosystem, working with digital materiality. I'm quoting Gramazio Köhler. Just a few steps, historical steps, before presenting the architects, some of the architects. So in 1945, mathematician John von Neumann is working about the theory of self-reproducing automata, studying cellular automates behaving like living systems, interfering with one another and self-reproducing the same way human cells do. And of course, now you know cellular automata. In the 50s, Alan Turing examined morphogenesis. René Thom also used mathematics and nature via morphogenesis. In 1967, at MIT, the Architecture Machine Group, created with Nicola Negroponte, is using for the first time the expression responsive architecture. In the 70s, Ilya Prigogine backed the self-organization of material and is talking about dissipative structure. At the same period, in the 80s, the physicist Stephen Wolfram, inventor of Mathematica software, is exploring the interaction between computation and nature, as well as models of complexity. I can also talk about Francisco Varela, working in the domain of cognitive sciences and working also on self-reproducing system of living. And also, for instance, Christopher Langton in Santa Fe in the United States in the 80s promoted artificial life as organization of information and studying how the behavior of certain systems simulates the living world. So the issue, of course, today is not to imitate nature, but to simulate nature through a generative approach and to artificially recreate this nature. And I will show you a few slides just introducing different kind of examples recreating artificially nature. And so the conference, the lecture, will be about the relationship between nature and artifice. Alessandra Sack is working with software like cellular automata. And for this architect, it's possible now to integrate contextual programming variables through cellular automata. Alessandra Sack is working like a genetic engineer, she told. She's using quote sequences to create, to recreate material forms of intelligence. And she's working with multi-agent systems, autonomous algorithms, driven by a swarming behavior, reacting each other. And these generative processes are directly linked to technologies of simulation. I'm quoting Alyssa. Architects can move beyond geometry to directly design the structure of matter itself. So Biosync is advocating for a synthetic ecology, a kind of both nature and artifice. And now the architect is able to produce new form of nature from generative principle and working like a digital ecosystem. This installation Bloom has been exhibited during the Olympic Games last year. And it has been designed by Alessandra Sack and Jose Sanchez. It's a kind of game of assembling elements according to a principle of dynamic proliferation. So you see rings, spirals, and yes, growing. And it's also a social and urban game, a participative tool, because each one can interfere with this installation. So you can take one module and put it where you want. And so it's completely interactive. And Alessandra Sack was also referring to the English tradition of gardening, but here it's a digital gardening. And but this kind of interactive principle are completely the same of the interactive principle of the living world. And it was the idea of Alyssa when she was designing this this installation to create a kind of new hybrid artifact. Here it's a project by Kokoujas, Roland Snooks, Robert Stuart Smith, and they are working also on self-organizational systems with notions of complexity and emergence. They are talking about messy computation, volatile interaction of algorithmic behavior. They are working through nonlinear systems of the genetic algorithms, interacting from one micro to macro, to the macro level. So this project is very interesting because you have this monolith shape completely eaten inside by this completely informal structure. And we have a kind of baroque-like dimension in this project, very surprising, because it's like the building was going beyond its own geometry. So Kokoujas has been working with self-similar algorithms and trying to create different fields of intensity. So you see the inside of this kind of monolith. So they are working at a multi-scaled level, working with multi-agent systems that you can see. And developing this kind of project. This one was designed for a competition in China. It was for a new museum in China. And they designed a kind of completely transparent emergent form, like a cloud or like a completely transparent membrane. This one is a prototype designed by Mark Furness, the very many. Mark Furness is working in New York, and he's also writing algorithmic protocols and working with also materials resistance. He was inspired for the first prototype by Gaudi, all the model experiments of Gaudi. And the prototype of Mark Furness are working with genetic algorithms and working also with a recursive logic, with a multiple strata of interaction. Here you have 9 interlocking spheres and different level of strata also that Mark Forn has designed. The idea was to create a kind of reversible architecture. So you can see from inside, from outside, it's like a kind of lace, of dentelle. And Mark Furness is working maybe a bit between architecture and sculpture. We can think of natural metaphors when we look at his architecture. And he's always working with large-scale prototypes, digitally designed and manufactured. And usually he's using aluminum strips or plastic strips, also, yes, digitally manufactured. And he went to in the region, region centre, and he designed this one at the Atelier Calder, where the famous artist Calder had his own workshop studio a few years ago. So you can have a look at the inside, modeling, simulation software made possible all these complex geometries that Mark Furness is using, working with empty, full scale, and which is also very specific to Mark Furness is the balance between, I would say, ornament and tectonic space. So empty and full space, material and non-material, in this kind of non-standard architecture. This pavilion was designed for the Fraxant collection, and it is very impressive because it's 10 meters long, maybe 6 meters high, and 4 meters large. So it's very impressive. When you are inside, you are like inside, I would say, a completely artificial landscape. You are like inside, I don't know, corals or sponge, or it's really very impressive. You can see from this this point of view the complexity of this structure. Of course, it's also very complex to build because there are thousands and thousands of aluminum strips, but the result is rather impressive. So you can have a look at the inside. You are thinking of an André Bloch sculpture habitacle. Maybe you know André Bloch in the 50s. He was advocating the relationship between architecture and sculpture. And we have the same strong issue in the Mark Furness prototypes. Andrew Codless is also working on the relationship between architecture, engineering, biology, computers. And for Andrew Codless, what is important is the material body of architecture, all the physical forces in architecture, the idea of growth, behavior. And he designed this wall, P-wall, for the SF MoMA. A few years ago. And recently we invited Andrew Codless to design a permanent mural installation for the new FRAC building made by Jacob McFarlane. And so you have a few digital slides of this wall. What is very interesting, Matt says Andrew Codless is working on the capacities on the capacity of matter's self-organization, on the convergence between organic and geometric issue. And this bas-relief is working on, you can feel the flexibility of the tissue, of the textile, and also you can feel the weight of the concrete materiality. So it's a very paradoxical space because you have both the elasticity of the skin and you have at the same time the weight, the mass of the concrete. And so everything is working all together. Working on the properties of the material and on the weight, the lines of forces of this material. And Andrew Codless was also to provoke that this installation overflow onto the visitors. So you have a kind of débordement of this structure in the physical space of the visitors. So the idea was also to have a kind of anthropomorphic relationship between the visitors and this architectural installation. We didn't want an object in the space, but really an architectural installation. Another architect which will be exhibited in Archilab is Skylar Tibbetts. Skylar Tibbetts Jett is an architect, designer, and a researcher in computer sciences at the MIT, and is working on the phenomenon of self-assembly as a constructive system. So he's working with self-folding proteins. And Skylar Tibbetts is thinking that architecture can build itself through self-assembling. And so the architecture has to be able to build itself, to repair itself, to transform itself, like a living organic material. And it's working with self-assembly of molecular structures that he would like to apply to the macro level of architecture. And as you know, the proteins have the ability to roll themselves and to reconfigure themselves. So they need an external activation. And so they can rebuild all the time themselves. And the idea of Skylar Tibbetts is to transpose this self-organization, self-assembly of proteins in architecture. So the issue of Skylar Tibbetts is how to reprogram materials, but at each level, across all levels, from the nano levels to the architectural levels. And for Tibbetts, biological systems are also building structures. So you can see some experiment that is doing always from the principle of the use of proteins. Yes, folding up and rolling up, yes, all the time, and that you would like to transpose to the architectural scale. Another very important architect and researcher today is Neri Oxman, material ecology. Neri Oxman is working at the MIT lab, and she's working on the field of convergence between biology, chemistry, neurosciences, and computer sciences. And so Neri is using material performances and the interaction with the environmental forces. And Neri Oxman told that materials are the new software today. Here you can see some prototypes that she designed, like recounting. And recounting, for instance, is sculpted in light. She's just resulting from the calculation of light rays, the intensity and position of this light rays. And of course, Neri Oxman is just working on the scale of prototypes now, but she's exploring the relationship between nature and artificial life. She's exploring the hybridization between nature and artifact, between geometry, physical matter, and energy. Here it's a new work that Neri Oxman designed a few years ago, maybe 2 years ago. Imaginary Beings, Mythology of the Not Yet. It's a work inspired by the tales of José Luis Borges. And so Neri Oxman created this kind of chimera of artificial creatures, but completely digital creatures, which are both animal, both artificial. And the idea of Neri Oxman is also to explore all the properties of matter, and similar to the behavior of living organisms. And Neri Oxman means that it could be possible to construct artifacts out of living matter. Here you have a prototype of Joris Laarman. Joris Laarman is a designer, a Dutch designer, a very young and very famous designer. And he designed in 2006 this chair, which is called Bone Chair. And he's collaborating with scientists, engineers, and his practice is completely between design and sciences, natural sciences. And he's using craftsmanship and also digital fabrication. What is very interesting in this chair, that Joris Laarman is an algorithmic translation of the phenomena of bone growth. So he studied like Darcy Thompson, you know, the book, the famous book of Darcy Thompson, Growth and Form, and it's the same idea, how the weight is producing a minimum of matter. So all the chair is organically growing like a bone. And when you sit, of course, it's a lack of unique prototype, but you have this thin dimension, thicker part, and everything is like the growth of a bone. And so it completely takes into account the laws of the biological world to design this materialization. And so in Archilab, we invited this time also designers because we would like to show that the same processes are also in different fields, design, graphic design, and so on, using natural sciences. Of course, you know Achim Menges working in Stuttgart. Achim Menges is surely one of the most important researchers today. And he's working with the matter itself, just the physicality of matter and all the properties of this matter, working with material behavior. The idea is to work with a kind of biomimetics, but the issue is to implement a biologically informed material system. So you have both architectural form, material formation, and structural performance. And you can see this pavilion, it has been commissioned by the FRAC, and it's the result of 5 years of result. It's called Hydroskin Meteosensitive Pavilion. And it's working on the hygroscopic and anisotropic behavior of wood. So you see that, you know that wood is working like a cellular structure. Wood is reacting to the humidity, reacting to climatic modification. And so the idea of Achim Menges was to put microparticles of wood in this structure. So you have a kind of weather-sensitive envelope which will naturally react. So the idea is you don't have anymore a mechanical device, you don't have an exterior device, but it's just the material which will perform and move and change the shape and the physicality of the pavilion. And Menges, it's advocating for a no-tech strategy and using nature and computation in the same program. And this pavilion will be exhibited for the first time. Here you have a detail. It has been exhibited at the Centre Pompidou in a former exhibition a few months ago, and with different levels of humidity. So you can see how these microparticles are moving, changing, and so on. And so the wood has been completely physically programmed to calculate different shapes in a responsive way. So here you can see a detail. So maybe it will be really the first time that an architectural pavilion is completely reacting in a natural way to the climate, to the environment. So when it is closed, open, and so on. And maybe you surely know this pavilion built, quite recently using elastic folding. And it was possible, also it was digitally produced and also fabricated with robots. and everything is integrating in the computing process. You have the computational design, the simulation, and the robotic fabrication. And the idea is only nature and computation can produce a sustainable architecture using the energy of the behavioral field. Another very important experiment has been taking place at the Frac Centre last year. It is really the first performance with flying robots by Gramazzo Köhler, Raffaello D'Andrea, and also the Frac commissioned this work, this research with ETH in Zurich. And the idea was for the first time to build this, I would say, proto-prototype. It is 6 meters high. And the idea is that a kind of model, maquette of a vertical village of 600 meters high. So the idea is you can live in this kind of urban structure. But what was very important is that everything was programmed with the flying robots. And it was the first time that you have a kind of three-dimensional architectural object ever built by flying robots. It's really a manifesto for robotic procedures, process applied to architecture. And Gramazzo Köhler, as you know, were among the first architects to advocate the connection between the digital reality and the material reality of architecture. They were really among the first architects to link digital architecture, digital processes, and robotic fabrication at the ETH and in Zurich. So you can see how the flying robots were reacting to each other. They were putting 1,500 modules of polystyrene. So they were picking up the modules, as you can see. And after, yes, it was like a little crash to pose the module on the structure, to put the module on the structure. So it took a few days, maybe 3 or 4 days, to build this structure. But for Gramazzo Köhler, digital systems are not about biological conditions for them. They are working in a completely different way. They are working with an associative thinking and not at all relying on biological conditions. So you can see the preparation with the of the modules. So yes, it has been a very impressive experience. And at the end, this structure. So we'll have also in this Archilab exhibition a new installation by Minimaforms. Theodore and Stephen Spiropoulos, and they're working in a completely also transdisciplinary research, combining art, design, architecture. And they design, I would say, a cyborg octopus with this luminous, flexible octopus. It's a kind of artificial creatures which will react to the visitors. So they can express moods, they have their own life, both living and both artificial. And Minimaforms is working on the idea of proto-architectural environments, participative models, and communication also models. And they design these artificial creatures to show us the link between nature and artifice, the link between affect and machine, and the relationship that we can create based on living organism. Now, yes, Ecologic Studio, and Claudia is here, so. And we commissioned, the Frac Centre also commissioned to Ecologic Studio this prototype. We know Ecological Studio also for a long time, and they were among the first studio also to talk about change of paradigm, a change of paradigm that is to say a shift from a mechanical paradigm to a machinic paradigm, and advocating for a systemic coevolution of different kind of matrices. And they design for the FRAC a metafolly. You know the folly, the architectural folly. It's a kind of fabric of nature from the Renaissance Manierist period up to now. And so they talk about a metafolly for the metropolitan landscape. And so they revisit the folly, the architectural folly, but this one is made with cables or electric wires, bits of plastics or urban trash cut out by prototyping machines. So it's a kind of extraction of the urban life, which is the material of this kind of machine, organism. And I was thinking of machine organism from Deleuze, because it's both animate and inanimate. You have both in the same project, and you have one space, but with many different hubs interfering with the visitors, because when you are approaching this architecture, you will interact, and you will interact also with the surrounding sounds, and so it's a completely living artifact. It's an artificial, but also a completely living artifact, which are talking about a new ecology of space and behavior, which is also a kind of low-tech and reloaded grotto, a psychological studio talk. And they compare architect to a cyber craftsman, and we're advocating for a slow architecture with both object, process, and interface for a kind of new body, which is also both an artificial creature and a machine, a kind of hybrid of nature and architecture. So you will see the real one in the exhibition. And here are the first steps of the project. Here, Commonwealth, there are also designers and working on a very strange, I would say, idea of design, because they are working also with craftsmanship approach and digitally manufacture. We have in the exhibition this project of Tom Folders, and he's developing also ecological and urban ecosystems. He developed this project for Dubai, and it's a kind of high-rise building. And this building is incorporating the environment, and it's a structural device absorbing the salinity in the air. So the building will grow. It's not at all a construction. It's a kind of growing building, because it's absorbing the salinity of the air, and you have a kind of crust of sediments. So the idea was to reproduce again the artificial life of a living organism. So Tom Folders designed this building like an environmental ecosystem. So you can see all the details of the device. We'll show some part of this prototype. And Tom Folders designed also this biofeed building. It's a completely cultivated building, because you have a kind of a fragmented, asymmetrical facade, but you have mousse, moss spores, the mousse, which are growing and transforming all the building into also a living organism, or a naturalized architecture. Here it's a bit funny. It's Erwig Baumgartner and Scott Uriu in LA. And they are also relying on medical technology, craft industry, filmmaking industry, and they design this kind of animated aperture. And it's a composite material, it's also interfering with the environment's conditions. So you can see of a kind of sea plant, and all the openings are organic materials. So these openings are also regulating the ventilation, regulating the energetic performance of the building. Soma is also, they build, it's an Austrian team, they built this pavilion in Korea. And they do it very recently, it's 2012. And they design a kinetic facade. It's like a fish opening and closing the doors, and also working on the idea of a natural ventilation. Servo Stockholm is also an experimental office in, you know, Servo, they are in different places. And here it's Marceline Gau and Ulrika Carlson. They design a hydrodynamic vegetal roof with many different kinds of biotopes and microclimates. And they were working with a beetle carapace found in the desert to design this also completely performative architecture. Jenny Sabin is also a very important researcher and architect. She's working, what is very interesting with Jenny Sabin is she's working in architectural field, of course, but also in the medical field. She's also working with engineers, and what she's developing is could be applied both to architecture, but also to biomedicine. I think it's a unique example that I know of an architect working really on the bridge of architecture and sciences. And Jenny Sabin is working on cellular behavior, like tectonic organization, and she developed e-skin facade project. So she's working on the nano level, and she's studying the cellular behavior, and she's trying to transpose this cellular behavior to a facade, to the macro level of the facade. And so the idea is how to use the phenomena of cellular adaptability to construct a building. And so she's working on biomechanical devices, biomimetic devices. And Jenny Sabin is also thinking that it could be possible to simulate and to inhabit also geometry as nature does. And she wants to design a livable artifact. Some Japanese architecture is a bit different, but there is a strong relationship to nature. And Akiza Hirata built this pavilion in Japan, in Tokyo. It is the Bloomberg Pavilion in the Museum of Contemporary Art in Tokyo. And to design this pavilion, he was studying mathematics and using genetic algorithms, and using the idea of also a completely natural growth of the architecture. So it's like a cloud, like I would say using triangles, isocel equilateral triangles, to create this proliferating structure. And again, Hirata is advocating that architecture has to rely on a biological system, and the change of scale is very important to go to the microprotein scale, to the macroforest scale. So the idea was to create different kind of folds. When you are inside the pavilion, you are like behind the tree. You have the same effect of the shadow of a tree. You know, surely Junya Ishigami, he's one of the most important Japanese architects today. a very young architect that he won many prizes at the different Biennale of Venezia. And it's not designing architecture, but architectural environments, our landscape of ambiguous space. Here it's a pavilion, Kanagawa Institute of Technology is the first building of Ishigami. And it's very interesting because it's a completely open space. You have a constellation of very thin columns. You can think that it is a kind of stochastic order, but it's a very mathematical and precise order. You have some columns in tension, some in compression, and you have a structural optimization of this architecture, which is completely based on natural processes. With Matthias Del Campo in Vienna and Sandra Manninger are working with parametric tools, simulating programs, and they designed this very interesting urban project based on the use of recursive logic. You know the principle of self-similarity of fractals, recursive geometry. And so they try to design another way to develop urban space and how to work with the urban density. And so here it's the grid. It could be Barcelona, it could be Los Angeles, it could be another city. And the idea was to take a grid and to study, to explore the natural progression through the principle of fractal and recursive formation. We invite also for this Archilab not an architect but a stylist. And Iris van Erpen is a very young Dutch stylist, dress designer. And she used to work with architects. She worked with Isaiah Bloch, Daniel Wiedrig, or Julia Körner. On the right is a dress made with Julia Körner. And Iris van Erpen, maybe she's 28 years old. Maybe she's the youngest guest of this Archilab. And there is a Baroque dimension of her dresses, but what is interesting is she completely working with technologies of the living and working with living organisms in the design of the clothes. And she's also convinced that there is a same way to approach architecture in dress designing, in design, in architecture, in sciences. They are all converging fields of research. And she's talking about mutation, a kind of new hybrid body, which is both natural and artificial. And the idea is so she designed with a 3D prototype, of course, printer, these dresses. And Neri Oxman made the last dress of Iris van Erpen recently. This is a series of dresses which were inspired by the carapace of microorganism carapace. Isaiah Bloch is also a young Belgian architect. He's interesting because he's working with the idea of the waste of time. So you see that in digital architecture, you have this idea of a growing, a development, and so on, growing process. But Isaiah Bloch is working with the dark side, I would say, of this digital architecture. Because the idea, if architecture can work like a living organism, why architecture is not a kind of organism in decomposition, which is completely deteriorated in a kind of destruction of itself, in fact. And Isaiah Bloch is working in a Baroque way, but the idea is to arrive at a step of decomposition, degeneracy of architecture. a kind of mutant forms for architecture, like ruins or a baroque disapparition. So we designed, for instance, these completely corroded elements for the table, or this kind of jewels. We will show also in Archilab, so just to end the last architects, Michael Hans Meyer is also a completely fascinating architect. He's working at the ETH at Zurich, and 2 years ago he designed these subdivided columns using algorithms of subdivision. Like a generative principle. So it's completely fascinating because it's millions of unique facets. It's completely crazy. You are like a kind of completely cellular world or biological infra-visible world. And we commissioned to Michael Hans Meyer a grotto, a kind of Manieris grotto, a Baroque grotto. So he worked with Benjamin Dillenberger to the design of this archetype of grotto, which is also a decomposition, subdivision of millions of facets. And he did it on sandstone at the real scale, one to one. So it will be a real physical architecture. You will be able to enter, and maybe it will be 3 meters high. So you will be completely surrounded by this grotto. So it's very strange because it's a kind of architecture, a grotto, a kind of naturalized architecture. And you don't know anymore the separation between nature and artifice through the use of this recursive algorithmic simulation. And I will quote Michael Hans Meyer. He was telling that he was not seeking to imitate nature, but the idea was to reference to the process of the evolution of nature. And we have a kind of grotesque, of completely naturalization of the architectural form. So you can see a detail of this prototype. I think that it will be really the first time, like the Gramazio flying robots performance, that we cut with prototyping machine such kind of prototype or proto-architecture. At the end of this lecture, I would like just to show you a few artists' work because they are also important. And Caceres, you know him, of course, because he's the inventor with Ben Fry of the programming language processing, and that everybody's using now. And Caceres is one of the first generative artists using also the phenomena of emergence and also working with the unpredictable mechanism of biological organism, of biological life in his creation. I think the best way, of course, it's a video work, so it's a bit frustrating just to look at a picture because it's completely evolving and interacting, of course. He's working with multi-agent system like an architect and also making connection between the natural and artificial life, and using the same process of naturalization through the simulation of the living world. And the last picture is a Perry Hall artist. Perry Hall is a very also interesting artist. He's is an American artist. And you can see these fascinating pictures, but it's not at all digital pictures. It's really painting. and that he's taking also movies, making movies from the animation of the inorganic. It's completely crazy because when you have a look at the films, the video, you are completely in an artificial world. You are thinking that you are in a biological world, but it's not at all the case. It's really painting and it's really a material world. So it's yes, very tricky to be really at the interface between. So this Archilab issue will, as you know now, work on the idea or examine the idea of nature and the idea of organizational models, and also to explore how we can go from one level to another level, how to go from the material level to the living level, and so on. Now, many architects are talking about network, a biological network. To quote Ecologic Studio, they are talking about a swarm, that architecture is working like a swarm. And this idea is also very interesting because we are back to what Manuel de Landa was telling a few years ago. He was talking about a principle of meshwork in a digital project. And this meshwork was really the link between organic and inorganic, between the material and the immaterial. And it was also this meshwork working like a swarm going in multiple directions. And so we are facing, I think, a kind of new artifact, multifunctional, hybrid, livable, sustainable artifact. But what it is, we don't know yet, and I don't know what it will become in the next years. Thank you.
If you agree, we can have a little moment of exchange and questions. Perhaps in the public there is some people who want to ask something to Marie-Ange. We hope. I start us today because they always I hope that some guy does the first question, but well, thank you very much, Marie-Ange, absolutely thank you. We are in absolutely complicity with the new evolution of Archilab, who is in the same way, absolutely in the same line, but with 10 years after or 6 years after, there is an enormous evolution in this line of action of innovation and new logic in architecture, and I think that the YAG is absolutely in this way of action and in this line of research. I was trying to understand why, when I read your lecture, was a naturalization of the architecture. And evidently, this relation with the nature was one of the factors of little change of mentality in the beginning of this new thinking was our ideas were not in relation with the forms of the city, the city and the tradition of the city and the traditions of the former city, but was a new relation between the cities, the nature, etc. The nature was always there, always in these ideas, because the nature was a kind of exterior in our generation was put together. But it's true that in 2003, I remember, 2004, too, it was Archilab, 2003, dedicate to the geography, to the topography. In there, in this moment, probably the nature was more landscape, was more topography, was more a kind of explain exchange with more landscape parameters of topographical parameters. And now, for you and for probably the big evolution is that this nature is nature of things, and this more relation with organisms of with bio genetical processes. Is true this, or is there evidently there are forms that can be similar to topographies, etc., but at the end there are more organisms, no? Is true the change of gaze to the idea of nature, or what's different between this Archilab issue about geographies, topographies, earth makers, grounds, and the new Archilab with the idea of nature? With the idea of non-standard at the beginning, this idea that these are kind of processes, not typologically modern senses, not prototypical, but more genotypical, no, in the sense. But well, perhaps we can open, Edouard. Thank you.
Very good. I don't really know how to formulate it, but I feel a little bit like we are in an haute couture catwalk in the 80s, where we see an absolutely crazy amount of objects or of images that are in a certain way very much disconnected from the daily reality that we are confronted to as non-architects, I would say, or as practicing architects. And I understand very well the way that you, I think at least, the way that you look at it and the way that you, where the interest comes from. What I struggle sometimes a little bit with is understand how we can evaluate sometimes the quality of a work outside of the realm of the process in which it's been designed. And the relationship that it has to contemporary means of both design and of manufacturing, and so there was one moment in your presentation where I thought we were touching a ground, which is when you showed the Ishigami project, because there, I think that maybe it's the project that is most. Most common, I would say, to how we understand that architecture can be in a more how can I say this? It's more common ground. No, it's easier to understand. But I think that in that project, for example, for me the fascination about that piece of work is how the consequence of having worked in a specific way are on space, and the way that the spatial organization is suddenly modified. And I think that, in my opinion, that's why there is an amazing innovation in that project. that's sometimes what I'm missing a little bit in this type of work, to understand how can we really evaluate it in terms of the consequence that it's going to have on our living environment and the way that we ultimately experience space.
Very proud that Claudia and Marco are there invited, and for us it's also a very interesting thing, and also we are very happy, and also all the students that we know that were involved collaborating in some projects, and it's for us a big pleasure. And perhaps
I have two questions, very simple. One is that maybe you can articulate a bit more for the student, even though the different projects already articulate, but a very simple question that is naturalized in architecture, but somehow we never see nature in the classical term we would intend nature. That I will have my answer for, but it would be nice to have as well yours, or what do you think we could explain to the student? I mean, the title is Naturalizing Architecture, no? And in a way, in all the image, we never see nature in the classical sense, how we imagine nature. So why do you think this is relevant? And also, in a way, how did you came about with the title Naturalizing Architecture? Why do you think it's interesting to naturalize architecture? Why architecture is going in the direction of somehow becoming a symbiotic element with ecology or nature or DNA or self-organization? Like this is kind of opposite to what happened in the Renaissance, no? So do you think this is a sort of natural ecology revolution, or what is the next step, or yeah?
I know it's hard to predict, but do you think that in the next 20 years we'll be still talking about this architectural style? And if not, what do you think we'll be talking about?
Oh, yes, and so we... So we completely explored this evolution of digital architecture. We never think that one time we will show flying robots building architecture. It was completely crazy. And so I don't know at all, but anyway, it depends on the architects and the architects' research. But we were just trying to have a kind of a kind of coupe at one time in one research in different countries and to have just an idea of what could be the research in architecture today. And what was very strong was this strong relationship with life science. But of course, maybe it will be completely obsolete within a few years. But Isaiah Block was for us very interesting because he's working with the idea of obsolescence, of deterioration, of the disparition, disappearance in the time, in a temporal approach. So it's not at all optimistic, it's a kind of nightmare. And maybe it's a new dark phase of this digital design processes that some architects are already developing.
To show in a way, and it's a question related with two basic elements that I think that they are important in architecture, which is scale and program. So I wonder, the majority of the project that you are showing and the majority of the project that we know that they are dealing with all this kind of new technology and biological parameters and information, they are all like in a very small scale. Basically, they are prototypes, or they are installations, or they are pavilions. But it's very difficult. You saw a couple of buildings that they are renders. And we're keep on talking that this is the architecture of today, but it rather seems that it is not yet, no? Because it doesn't made this big step of scale, or it doesn't really have clear applications. There are some, no doubt, but it's not what we're experiencing today, not in construction, not in the real world, no? So what...
experimental work. So Jenny Sabin is working on, would like to work on the macro scale of the facade of the building, but it's very complicated from the cellular division to the macro level. And Mary Oxman is also complaining that she has to make all the experiments on a small scale, which is the scale of the 3D prototyping machine, because she cannot go beyond the scale of the tools. And that it's a kind of limit of the research. It's for that reason that in this issue edition of Archilab, we commission to architect pavilions, also to ask to architect to experiment another scale. It's the Metafoli Pavilion of Ecologic Studio, the pavilion of Akim Menges is really the first interactive pavilion working with humidity levels. It's also a completely new patent in architecture. And Marc Fornes, it will be also a pavilion, and so on, Hans Meyer. And we wanted that the visitors experiment another scale, because usually all the criticism that we have for Archilab is it's just a model and that's it. And so for us, also a model, you have seen the models of Alisa and Rasek. You have all the design process. It's very complex and it's completely fascinating. But sometimes it's not very pedagogical to just show the models. And so the idea was really to experiment a new kind of space. But it is true that the issue of the scale is one of the main issues. Hmm. The marijuana models, because they are living models, evolving organisms, and but we don't have to stay too much in the room, not before the lecture.
One year and a half ago, the book about parametricism, and is now thinking to do an exhibition and etc. And many of the project that you show resemble in geometry a sort of parametric idea. Which kind of connection do you see between naturalizing architecture and parametricism? Do you see some connection? Do you see it as antagonist?
Oh, because many different architects in the exhibition are working with parametric tools. And for instance, Matias del Campo, it's really in the his language. And so there is no opposition. And in that exhibition, there are some architects who are referring to, you know, the American philosopher Graham Harman, working on the object-oriented philosophy, working on the idea of the status of the object, which is completely different of Patrick Schumacher parametricism. And for instance, David Rui and Carol Klein are related to this, new approach of not architecture, because he's not writing on architecture. But I think there is no opposition, really. It's different ways of looking also and designing processes. So. Thank you.